Hi, I'm Sebastian, and I'm going to talk about an in-depth look at APT signals today. So, if any one of you thinks APT stands for Advanced Persistent Threat, this is the point in the talk where you can still leave, because it's a talk about signal processing. And it's a talk about a rather old and odd signal format that is used by weather satellites. So, just a quick introduction. People told me after my previous talks that I need a slide like that, because people want to contact me afterwards. So, yeah, if you have any questions and you can't find me afterwards, here's how to contact me, and maybe that you know my background and that you know where I'm coming from. I'm an applied scientist. I'm an applied computer science student, and yeah, I'm going for the mad scientist look. And yeah, I'm not yet a radio ham radio operator. I'm working on that. So everything that is about basically about radio transmissions and stuff like that. You should be quite careful with that. I learned that from the internet. There's a lot of interesting stuff on the internet, but also a lot of wrong stuff. So, to continue this disclaimer, this talk is more about decoding the signals than it is about receiving them. It is also an improved version of a talk I gave previously this year at the Meta Rhein-Main Chaos Days. And I basically wanted to do the same talk again with less fuck-ups and in English, but I decided to shift the focus a little bit. Yeah, as you might notice, this talk is also in English, and it may contain some trace amounts of math and integrals, because a lot of these things get easier if you take a quick look at the math. And it's also, it basically shows my ongoing effort to understand this kind of stuff. So there might be still things in there that are wrong. There might be things in there that are oversimplified, but I'm working on that. So, big question that I always get: why did I even look at ATP and at the NOAA weather satellites? Well, back in 2015, I was at the camp. I got a radio and a T-shirt, and I needed something to do with it. So everyone likes space stuff, and the NOAA satellites are quite handy as a Hello World example for decoding satellite signals. Why are they quite handy? Well, they are satellites with cameras, which means you get pictures. Everybody likes cool pictures from space, so that's a nice motivation. Also, everyone has permission to receive and to use the data, so nothing illegal here. For your information, it's actually pronounced NOAA, so it's the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, which is pronounced NOAA, if you can read the nice symbols here. And the satellites I'm talking about are polar orbiting environmental satellites, which means they are in low Earth orbit, like for example NOAA 19, which has a perigee, which is the lowest point of its orbit, of 850 kilometers, and an apogee of 869, so it's rather a circular orbit. And it has an inclination. This is the angle of the orbit towards the equator of 98 degrees, so it's I'll show you a picture. Yep, this one. So they go almost like this in a vertical direction over the globe, and since the Earth rotates underneath them, they basically scan the whole Earth from south to north, or depending on the path, from north to south. And so for any specific point on the Earth, you will meet a satellite at least 3 times a day with a good path where you can actually receive data and try to decode it. That's an image of NOAA 19, and that's also an image of NOAA 19 a few weeks later. This is what they called a severe lag in procedural checks. Somebody forgot to screw the satellite down before they tilted the platform. The damage was about, I think, $300 million. And yeah, the manufacturer who did this had to pay for a new satellite. So just a little bit of history, because I said it's signal decoding like it's 1978. The first NOAA satellite was started a little bit earlier. The last one was started in 2009, after they rebuilt it because they dropped it. And they are mostly based on the newer ones are based on the Tyros N series, which has been manufactured since 1978. That's why there's the title. And operational, there are three left of them. They are more or less damaged. So for example, NOAA 15, if I recall correctly, the IR sensor is broken, so you only get a picture in the visible spectrum. NOAA 18 works fine as far as I can tell, but the transmitter is a bit wonky. And NOAA 19 is the best of them, because it's the newest. The nice thing is they are all, even though the newer ones have better ways to transmit pictures, they all still do APT, and so that they are backward compatible to old receiving stations that have been built in the 70s. The signals they transmit, there are basically two kinds of signals that you get from them. The first one is the one I'm talking about today, which is automatic picture transmission, which happens somewhere around 173 megahertz, which is, if you're a ham radio operator, it's directly below the 2 meter band. They use channels with 34 kilohertz of bandwidth, which is also doable for ham radio equipment. And they use a rather weird coding scheme that is basically frequency modulation, but they also mixed amplitude emulation with it, and they transmit circular polarized. I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes in a bit more detail. And they also do high resolution picture transmission, which is on 1.7 gigahertz and has a lot more bandwidth and is a digital thing. And it needs tracking antennas, and it needs weird microwavy receiver technology that I haven't fully understood yet, and so I haven't looked at that any further. So, if you want to receive the signals, you'll need a circular polarized antenna, which is something like this one. You need a software-defined radio, of course. You can do it with your regular ham radio rig if you connect it to a sound card, but a software-defined radio makes the thing really easy. You need a recorder to record the signals, and you need a decoder for them. The recorder mostly comes with the software for your SDR. The decoder, I'm also going to talk about decoders. And you might also need a low noise amplifier and a filter, because depending on where you are and what kind of stuff is around you, you might have a lot of noise in that band, and then you will need a band pass. And basically it's as easy as that. You connect your antenna to your low noise amplifier, you connect that one to the SDR, you run your SDR software, you get a WAV file, you put that in your decoder, you get a PNG file, you're done. So, it's not quite that easy. Let's start with the antennas. I brought you this one, which is my own design, and it's basically two twisted conductive loops that are connected to the coax up top. And the interesting thing is, why do the satellites even send the polarized signals if you need funny antennas like this to receive it? Well, it's a really simple answer to that. If you don't send a polarized signal, the atmosphere will polarize it for you, and it will be polarized randomly, and you will get fading. And the other nice thing about it, the orientation of the antenna on the satellite and your receiving antenna doesn't matter. So especially these quadrilateral helicoidal antennas, they have the property that they receive from horizon to horizon with equal gain. So if you know, for example, the image of the sensitivity of a Yagi antenna, which is usually something like that, so it's a big hump in one direction and nothing in the others, for this thing it would be basically a sphere cut in half. So that's perfect for receiving satellite passes, and also you get rid of the polarization that would be done by the atmosphere. And how do you get one? Well, the easiest way is to build one. The one on the left is the first one I built, which is basically a piece of PVC pipe, some leftover cable, some pieces of wood, which worked, kind of. And the other one is the one that's linked in here down below, which you can't read that well, I just realized. And that one, you can 3D print the parts, you can add the PVC pipe pieces, and you just have to thread the wire through, and then you're done. The thing is usually in tune with about plus minus 2.5 megahertz directly after building it. So, the next thing is, you need that low noise amplifier, because most likely, you are like me, you are living in a city, or at least near a city, there's a lot of noise, and you will need some filtering and some amplification to get a clear signal. That's the first one I built, which simply uses a transistor, which works quite well after it warmed up and after you tuned it, and if you transport it from one place to the other, you have to retune it. So I tried to make something better and came up with this design that uses some modern monolithic amplifier chip, and I didn't get the filter right until today. So that one is still work in progress. It works as an amplifier without a filter, but the whole filtering thing is new to me, and I sincerely hope that I get it right at some point in the future. Just watch the GitHub repository. As soon as it works, it will be up there. So for those who don't like schematics, that's how they look in the real life. So the one that looks really DIY is the one that uses the one transistor, and the other one I had a board made for the one with the amplifier chip, and now I'm a little bit frustrated that it didn't work out the way I planned it. But it was my first endeavor in doing boards for radio frequencies, so that was somehow to be expected. You also need an SDR. Of course, you can use a radio badge, which works fine, but it's a bit inconvenient if you are aiming for an automated setup or something like that. So for that, I can recommend RTL SDR, which is basically a DVB-T stick for watching television with some modified software running on your computer. And they're really nice. They have enough bandwidth. They have the right frequency range. They cost literally nothing, and you can also watch TV with them, which is no longer true in some areas, and I would not consider that one a feature. So let's talk about the signals themselves. So APT is similar to WeatherFax, if some of you know that, but only similar. It's not really the same thing. We talk about pixel-wise transmissions. We transmit 2 lines per second, and we have 2,080 pixels per line, or 4,160 pixels per second. And basically, the pixels are grayscale brightness levels. So it's an analog video signal with that line rate and that many pixels. And if you look at the frame, there's a lot of stuff in there, so the funny thing is they called it channel A video. So where channel A video and where channel A, where channel B video is, there you will get a still frame of basically the satellite flying over you. Then there's this sync A and sync B, which will be relevant later, which tells you where a line starts, or in case of sync B, where the middle of the line is. And you will have also this numbered things, the telemetry frames, and the telemetry frames tell you things about the health of the satellite and how cold or how warm the infrared sensor is, stuff you need to interpret the pictures correctly. I haven't really looked into them. I roughly know what is where, but they don't really matter for decoding the frame. For decoding the frame, you have to know how many pixels there are, and that there's a sync marker and another sync marker, and that's enough. Of course, you can look at the telemetry and take a look at all those values. They are basically encoded as grayscale bars beside the images. But for NOAA 15, they don't make that much sense anymore, at least when I tried to read them. And for the other ones, yeah, I never needed them so far. You might need them if you want fake color images, so you can combine the IR and the real light image to get a normal, a fake color image like you know it from the weather in TV. But I've never done that. So my to-do list. So this is the thing in action. You can see the sync markers. You can see the telemetry frames. Some of them have a fixed color so that you can judge the contrast of the image. And let's have a look at a single line of those. So that's a single line displayed basically as analog values from 0 to 1. And you can see the sync markers, you can see that there are some really bright pixels, some really dark pixels, some intermediate stuff in between. And if you take a closer look, we see this. And everyone that has ever done analog signal processing, because we are talking about 70s technologies here. So they had not really the capabilities to run that stuff through a DSP or something like that. A lot of the stuff I'm going to talk about now has been done analog, at least on the first satellites. So we see we have a DC offset because the whole signal is above the zero line, which is not that bad. We can get rid of that with a capacitor. But the bigger problem is, look at those basically steep flanks. That's almost a square wave signal. So if you know a square wave signal, we have a lot of harmonics in that thing. So all those nice little peaks there, those are basically the harmonics generated by the sync markers. And if you run that through analog filters, you will get pretty interesting results, but it won't work as you expect it to. And you also waste a lot of bandwidth with that thing, because you can filter out some of the harmonics, but if you filter out too many, your nice steep flanks will get rounded and your image will look blurred. So you have to find a way to deal with them. And the way to deal with them is, before we do anything else with the image, we perform an amplitude modulation. So we take a sine wave, we multiply our pixel value with the sine wave at that position, and it gets rid of all the DC, and it makes the thing to a nice little sine wave that looks like this for a whole line. As you can see, the DC offset is gone, and if we look at the same portion of the signal again, it's a lot less square wavy. It's still not ideal, it still has huge jumps in it, and it will generate some harmonics, but it's a lot better. So, and if you look at this one, you can also see that's the Fourier transformation of the modulated signal. You can also see that we've moved a lot of the low frequency stuff more to the middle, where our 2.4 kilohertz carrier wave is, and we've generated this hump at the beginning, which contains our signal, and we have the noise floor after 5,000 hertz, which is pretty nice for transmitting the thing. So now we can just transmit it, right? No, we can't. Transmitting AM from space is a really bad idea. because most of the interferences you get, like clouds that move into your transmission path, like for example storms, so you might want to look at your weather satellite when you are in the middle of a storm, because then the weather is kind of important to you, and if you just transmit AM, yeah, you might get through, but the resulting image will be all over the place. So everything, every interference you will get will directly influence the brightness of your pixels, and everything will look messed up. So you have fading due to weather, the satellite moves, so if it moves behind a building or if it comes up behind the mountain, the signal will get stronger or weaker, and it will also change your brightness for a few lines, and then it will go back to normals. And you will also have something, a word that I learned recently, flutter fading, which is a nice German word for your antenna pole is wonky and your antenna starts moving and you get fading because of that. So the way we deal with that is we do frequency modulation. So now I've got this complicated looking term that contains an integral, and the x in this case is our signal, and we have to integrate over it, and we are still in the 70s and we don't have DSPs and we have to do it analog and we have to build an integration amplifier and stuff like that. No, we don't. Luckily for us, xt is a sine wave, and we can simplify the thing a lot if we know that the signal we are modulating onto our sine is a sinusoidal signal. So we end up with something like that. And that is not really important for you now, but I will use exactly that expression later on in the talk, so I've just shown it to you now. So that's basically the satellite part done. We've got a camera, we've got a sine wave, we've got our carrier wave that goes into our FM modulator, we've got our radio that, or better, our amplifier that's responsible for transmitting the whole thing. And now we have to look at the ground station part, because we now have AM in FM, and somewhere there are our brightness values, and we have to start decoding the whole thing. And we don't want to end up with something looking like that. So how do we go about it? The first thing is we have to demodulate the FM so that we can get our AM signal back. Then we have to demodulate the AM somehow and get rid of that sine wave we multiplied on. And then we basically have brightness values in a stream, and we can write them to a file as pixels, and yeah, we can do other stuff with it. And in the end, it's fun and profit. Now we can break out GNU Radio and we can look for flow graphs online that do exactly that, and we will find stuff like that, which doesn't even work that well because they made some assumptions that are not really true for all SDRs, and I wonder how it worked in the first place, but okay, we will just use GQRX, because it comes with this nice narrow FM decoder, which I've selected here. And if you can see something like that in the audio FFT, one big peak with 2.4 gigahertz and two side humps, then you are perfectly right and you can record it, and you might have a pretty good chance of decoding it. The question is, how do you decode the thing? Because GQRX gives you a wave file that contains still the AM signal, so we have to get rid of the AM somehow. There are two tools available that you will find when googling. One is WX to IMG, which is closed source. It has some features that might come handy if you're dealing with weak signals that are only available in the pro version, which is something that I don't like that much, that there even is a pro version. And also, if you feed it a really weak and noisy signal, it will just say, hey, I can't decode that, there's nothing in there. Then there's ATPDEC, which was written by a French guy, therefore they swapped two letters in the acronym, because that's what the French do, obviously. That one is open source, but it's written basically by a ham radio operator, and he looked at an analog circuit to do the job and then decided to digitize that one. So he implemented a PLL, he implemented a feedback filter for the PLL, and I would not say he did it wrong. It works, and it works exactly as it's supposed to, but he wasted a lot of resources doing so, because if you do the same thing completely digital, it gets a lot easier, and you have a lot less problems with certain things like noise or PLL that starts drifting or numerical imprecision in your floating point calculations, stuff like that. Also, it is unmaintained, so if you feed it certain signals, it wants to know which satellite it was. You say NOAA 19 and it says, oh, NOAA 19, I don't know about that one. And the most problematic thing I found with those tools are they are not implemented here. They are not invented here. So I had to come up with my own solution. And I decided, okay, I'll write my own decoder. It will be fully open source. I will use stuff that I learned while studying about digital signal processing that I didn't apply anywhere else and which I thought could be put to good use. And I wanted it to be relatively simple. I wanted everyone to be able to understand it. So no PLLs. Just one filter, which is a low-pass filter, which is a really simple FER filter. And it's coded in Rust, because somehow I liked Rust at that point. And if you look at it, it's basically an AM demodulator, which I'm going to explain shortly, because not everyone has seen AM demodulation like this. Then it's low-pass filter, an upsampler and downsampler. Some synchronization, and then we can write out a PNG image. So I told you this is the thing we ended up with. That's the modulated signal. It looked like that. And what we now want to do is something called square law demodulation. Not many people have heard of that one before. At least not many people I talk to. If we look at that thing and we say, hey, just multiply it with itself and see what happens, then we'll end up with something like our original signal squared, and our original signal squared multiplied with a cosinus wave with 4 times the frequency, or let's say 2 times the frequency, because we had a 2 in there initially and now we have a 4. So what we basically get is our initial brightness values that we modulated, and then some stuff that has a much higher frequency than our video signal. So if you look at, yeah, and then we can basically do a square root on that and do a low pass filter, and we're there. So if you look at that one, that's the same signal as before, but I squared it, did an FFT again, and as you can see, I basically moved the carrier all the way up to 4.8 kilohertz, and there is no, the video signal, as I told you initially, has 4160 pixels per line, or per second, per 2 lines. So our video signal, even if we do alternating black and white pixels, which is the worst case, which would be the fastest rate of change we can have in that signal, it would be still slower than twice the carrier. So we can simply use low-pass filter to get our original signal back and do a square root on that one. Or we can even do a square root beforehand and then use low-pass filter, which is not a very nice thing to do, but it still works. The other thing is I talked about up and down sampling. And the other tools, they actually interpolate when upsampling. So if you give them an input like 0.84, they will try to fill in the gaps by linear interpolation, or maybe they do quadratic interpolation, but they will come up with numbers to fill the gaps. If we do downsampling anyway, why do we need to interpolate? I mean, we sample up by factor 15, we sample down by factor 130, so most of the interpolation we do will be dropped in the downsampler, or at least will be chopped up, and only a fraction of it will be used in the downsampler. So what we can do is simply do something like that, just add zeros, and then we can integrate a low-pass filter in our downsampler. Low-pass filter will smooth that one out, will basically do the interpolation for us, but we can add the low-pass filter after our downsampler, because the downsampler would need the low-pass filter anyway. And due to the very nice properties of the frequencies involved here and the math involved, everything works out just fine for us. The last thing we need to do is we need to sync up the lines somehow. So we've now got an audio signal that has some choppy noise somewhere in it. And we have to basically make sure that whenever the choppy noise turns up, we are either in the middle of the frame or we are at the start of a new line. So what I did, I simply typed down the sync patterns as arrays, ran a ghetto version of cross-correlation on that thing, and if it correlates enough, I simply insert the sync symbol in my data stream, and then my PNG writer can set X and Y coordinates accordingly, and then we're basically done. So it's basically as simple as that. We've got our demodulator, we've got our low-pass filter, we've got an upsampler, we've got a downsampler, and in the end, we end up with a frequency that's just exactly the pixel frequency, and we can write that out to a PNG file, make sure that we got the lines right, and that's that. So to promote this talk, I did a little challenge on Twitter and tweeted a video like this, which had an APT signal embedded in the audio. And I said, okay, anyone who can hand me a decoded version of that, printed out on paper, basically up to right now, will get a free chunk. So far, I've gotten one. So I don't know if it was too hard, because my GitHub repository with the decoding tool is directly linked at my Twitter account, or nobody cared, or it was too easy for some people and too hard for others, I don't know. I'm a bit disappointed by that one. In case anyone cares, that's the solution. Because in order to write a decoder, I wrote an encoder that basically does all the modulation for me, and now I can transmit and I can be my own weather satellite if I need signals for testing. Yeah, and that's basically it. I can show you a few pictures because I don't have a clock here on this display. Can anyone tell me how many minutes we have left? Okay, I've still got a lot of time left, so I can show you a few pictures. So that's something that WX2IMG generates with a weak signal, if you can get it to generate anything at all. That's something from my decoder. I have quite a few mishaps and also quite a few problems with noise in my signals. I'm hoping to get a better setup so that I can show you more, but if you're really trying to do that yourself, you will end up with a lot of decoded passes that look more like that one, or even in the worst case like that one. And in some cases you will get really nice ones like this one, even though you can see by the markers at the side that the contrast is totally off. That's a nice one. That has all the right contrast. Yeah, are there any questions?
Yeah, thanks at the beginning. I think we can give him a warm applause. So are there any questions?
Why is there so much noise in the picture if the marker is clear?
It really depends on. So that's not an artifact of the decoding. It's more or less a thing of how your SDR behaves in combination on what with what kind of noise you have on the system, and you may end up with something like that or you may not. The nice thing about the marker is that the signal will be a constant sine wave at that point for quite a long period of time, whereas in the picture it always changes amplitude. So it's a lot easier to get that stable sine wave through the ADC and through everything that comes behind it, and it's I think it's a lot less susceptible to noise. At least that's my best guess.
So the first analog data you showed there, I think there was some clipping inside or something. At least it was cut off, right?
Yeah.
Is that a problem with SDS or
no,
is that a problem for decoding?
No, that's not really clipping. In fact, the data you've been seeing there is a line of this image. So the thing you saw that looked like clipping were part of those really bright marker stripes in the middle of the image. And in the beginning of the image. So that's not really clipping. The signal looks like this. It has these edges. It's not like, so if you say clipping, I assume you have some experience with audio or something like that. So in audio, if you talk about human voices and stuff like that, they are usually quite round and sinusoidal. And if you talk about pictures and image data, it will have edges like that and flanks like that, and it will just look like that. If you stay on a really high brightness value for a prolonged period of time, you will get exactly that. Which is why we do the AM modulation in the first place, because we want to get rid of that.
Would a bigger antenna help?
Bigger is not better in that case. So the tune of the antenna is given by its size, so I assume you mean an antenna with more gain, a better antenna. Yes, it would definitely help. So the best thing to do is what the people from Satnox, who are also here at the Congress, just right out the stage here do. They've got tracking Yagi antennas, which they point directly at the satellite, and they have like 50 decibels of gain, and with them you get a lot clearer pictures. So the nice thing about these antennas is they are so omnidirectional and rather broadband, so you don't need to worry too much about tuning or pointing it in the right direction. You can just stick it on a pole and it works. And if you want to do something with a Yagi, you have to point it at a satellite, which is hard to do by hand, so you need to construct a rotor for it, and yeah, then you get a whole lot of other problems. So it's something I'm planning on doing, definitely, especially since I want to run a Satnox ground station now after talking with the guys, but yeah, it's in the future. So for a beginner, I would recommend just building the antenna and playing with it. I mean, you get low noise amplifiers on eBay for $10. You get you can build the antenna for, I think, the one that I have with me here cost me not even €20. You can get the SDR for €7 from eBay, and then you're good to go. So I basically went with the beginner-friendly setup, and I'm currently working on improving that. Ah, there's another one.
Would you think that a better SDR like the HikRF would improve the signal? And are you using currently the RTL SDR dongle?
The
pictures you showed, did you record them with the DVB-T dongle?
Yeah, I mostly use the DVB-T dongle. I mean, I have a radio, which is basically a clone of the HKF. But I don't know about the HKF specifically, but I can tell you some things about the radio. So the radio uses a WiMAX tuner chip, which was specified for frequencies well above 2.4 gigahertz. And it's a bit, yeah, it's not as sensitive as it would need to be in the 2 meter band, which is also something ham radio operators have observed with it right from the beginning. And it wasn't that much the intended use case. So the radio was initially intended to do Iridium and GSM and WLAN, Wi-Fi. So using the radio doesn't work too well. I don't know about the HackRF, to be honest. I would need to have a HackRF and give it a test. Oh, what? Yeah, something like Lime SDR. I actually had on the I had Lime SDR as an alternative on the slides for the longer version of this talk, and I haven't tried it, but people in the internet report that it works really well. You can also think about something like the FunCube dongle, if you can get your hands on one, which has an integrated LNA, which should work great for this kind of stuff. So yeah. I just picked the RTL SDR because it's cheap and available and everyone can get it and play around with it.
Yeah, thanks again. I think great talk, and we could give him another warm applause, and yeah.
Yeah.